Hey, this is Katrin Davis-Daughter, winner of 2015 CrossFit Games, and you're listening to The Expansion Project.
Hey guys, before I start the show, I want to tell you all about a new company that I just launched that I'm super excited about. It's called breakparallel.com. I have teamed up with a friend and partner of mine named Jarrett Scheinman, and we have put together a website that pulls together all the best content from the functional fitness community. So that means videos from your favorite companies and of your favorite athletes. It also means lots of cool photo galleries. Plus, we're going to do some giveaways. We're going to have a great newsletter that's going to have some exclusive offers in there. So please bookmark breakparallel.com. Check it out every day for all the updates. And of course, tell your friends about it, post on your social networks about it, and help us get the word out there. Let's go again. Can you get through the red leather, yellow leather?
Red leather, yellow leather, red leather, yellow leather, red leather, yellow leather, red leather, yellow leather, red leather, yellow leather. Red leather, yellow leather.
That's pretty damn impressive, man.
You know what I can't say is toy boat.
Toy boat, toy boat, toy boat, toy boat, toy boat, toy boat, toy
boat. There you go. You nailed it. Now say it faster.
Toy boat, toy.
Yeah, I'm going to mess with you, though.
All right, we're rolling. Welcome back to another episode of the Expansion Project Podcast. I am your host, Fat Tony, and on this show, I have casual yet deep conversations with professional athletes, coaches, authors, bloggers, entrepreneurs, investors, musicians, and anybody else that I deem to be successful or just interesting. And the hope is that I will expand my mind and yours while motivating and inspiring people along the way. My guest today is Scott Mcgee, who is one of the co-hosts of one of my favorite podcasts, the Wodcast Podcast. In addition to being a host on the show, he is also a police officer and a member of the SWAT team and a very dedicated husband and father. I was a big fan of Scott before I talked to him, and I got to tell you, after this conversation, I'm even a bigger fan. The guy just has such an incredible heart and such a really, really great perspective on life and family and relationships, and I think that just comes across so well in this interview. So I'm really excited to share it with you guys, and without further ado, let's jump right into it. Before I welcome my guest, I want to thank you guys for all the great feedback. My inbox keeps getting hit with messages. My social media keeps blowing up. So thank you guys for all the support on the podcast. It really means a lot to me. Also, thanks for all the 5-star ratings and the reviews on iTunes. I'm going to continue to read some of the best reviews on iTunes here. And we've got one from Jaman420. He says, Fat Tony interviews some of my biggest heroes and people that I've never heard of, but I'm glad he introduced me to. Fat gets close to these power players and gets to ask them the questions that we would love to ask. Huge motivation, lots of inspiration. So thank you for that comment, Jaman420. And if you guys want to go leave a comment on iTunes, I will read it here on the show. Only if it's a good one, though. Also, just a reminder, please go to theexpansionprojectpodcast.com and click on the affiliate links on the right side of the page. When you buy some cool stuff from those links, it'll help out the show. Most importantly, the one for Nutrisuma.com. You use the promo code FATTONY1 and get 20% off of all your supplements and everything on your order. Now I will welcome my guest to the show, Scott Mcgee. Thank you so much for inviting me to your man cave, and I appreciate you letting me come out here tonight.
No, thank you.
So I was a fan of the Wodcast podcast for probably about a year or so when I met you. And when I did meet you, it was earlier this year at the OC Throwdown. I wasn't very well connected in the fitness industry at that point. But you were extremely friendly and just super personable to me. And you just made a really great impression on me right away. So first of all, I want to thank you for that. But I'm also curious as to your kind of thought process behind meeting fans, because at the time I kind of was a fan. That's sort of how I presented myself, even though I was the photographer there at the event and I was sort of an industry person at that point. Is fan interaction something that you sort of consciously think about as, you know, a host of the podcast?
I know there's fans, but I don't really look at it like that. Mm-hmm. The Wodcast podcast is something that I started off as a listener. Mm-hmm. I came on as a guest, I think episode 12 or 14, and maybe somewhere in the 20s. But it's a show that I do as a listener first. And then as a guest, I know what it's like to be a guest on that show. And then thirdly, as a host. Mm-hmm. And so I don't really look at it as like a fan thing. I just look at it as us and we and enjoying something together.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Got it. Well, again, you came off great, and we started texting kind of a little bit back and forth after that, and I just thought it was super cool. And I know kind of from my past experience that when you do make a good impression on somebody that's, you know, a fan of your work or whatever, it makes them an even bigger fan, and it makes it that much more personable when I listen to the show or whatever. So thanks for that.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. So let's talk about the background a little bit. I don't know you all that well, so give me some of the basics on your background, maybe kind of, you know, even a little bit of where you grew up, getting into some of your career stuff, and obviously we'll dig into the details a little bit more, but give me some of the basics.
All right. Well, I am one of the few people that was born and raised in Los Angeles and stayed here.
Yeah.
And that's where we're recording right now. I grew up in Santa Monica. I have a younger sister, and I grew up playing a lot of sports. I did just about any sport that you can think of, except casually tennis. I didn't really get into tennis too much. And come to think of it, I actually had overuse injuries in elementary school. Looking back at it, my dad was driving me around from one practice to the next practice, and that's kind of where I started learning how to take care of myself in that sense. So, but grew up in a great family in Santa Monica, about a block away from the beach. My dad kind of handled the athletic side of me, and my mom handled the academic stuff. So I had a good balance there, good balance in community, as far as anything a kid could want out of their parents, I got. So I'm very lucky in that sense. And, moving way forward ahead now, I am doing that for my kids, which is a whole full circle thing that I think is really cool.
Yeah.
But I grew up playing sports, and then I once I got to high school, I started really keying in more on football and track, mainly football. Ended up going to UC Davis, where I played football there. And then after that, I signed up with a sports agent, trying to think, maybe I keep going, keep playing some more football. And I started looking like more like the Canadian Football League, possibly, or Arena Football League. And a couple of things happened to me during that time. One of them, prior to that, actually, my second to last year in college, I blew out my hamstring really badly. And that was one of the moments that shaped my life to this day. It totally taught me about personal responsibility. If you get an injury, a lot of people don't necessarily take the full grasp on what it means to take personal responsibility for your predicament. And so for a long time, I blamed other people. I blamed, why are the trainers not training me well enough? Or why is this happening? Instead of taking full responsibility for it. So that was a whole 9 months of rehab, learning how to lift my foot up off the ground again, and then taught me about hard work and pain and desire to attain goals.
And how old were you at this point?
21, probably.
Okay.
After college, or toward the end there, when I was still doing the whole football thing, I was on the field one day running, doing cone drills, with, by myself, working on some shenanigans, and it hit me. I was like, I made it through about 16 years of full contact football, and I hadn't had any surgeries, which is like, to this day, I'm pretty proud of, to make it, and no broken bones, nothing. The worst thing was my little boo-boos here and there. But then it hit me like, you know what? I'm happy. Like, I made it this long. I had a great time. I learned a lot. And I still want to be able to, at the time I was thinking, I still want to be able to play frisbee at the park or frisbee at the beach. And I felt like my time was coming if I were to keep pushing it. And so that was it. I just walked off, grabbed my cones. I was like, that was it.
Wow.
And I was happy because it was that little chapter of my life. And no matter how big it feels to you at that moment, if you look at the big picture, it's only, less than a third of your life. A little bit less than that, maybe a quarter of your life. You still have the majority of your life ahead of you to stay healthy, to climb rocks, to BMX, to go do stuff. And I felt like I was pushing my luck. And but I was happy. And that's like the best thing you can ask for in somebody.
Yeah.
Is to be happy and content with and proud. And then that was it.
That's interesting. I don't feel like a lot of people have kind of like an exact moment when a light bulb goes off in their head and they just sort of walk away from something they've done for so long. Like, it seems like for most people that would be a bit more of a gradual decision of some sort.
Yeah, I think having a really grasped, whether it doesn't matter what it is in life, but if you can grasp the big picture, or If your 85-year-old self were to come back in time right now, what would he tell you? Mm-hmm. He or she tell you? And most people like take for granted that moment. Like my 85-year-old self would love to come into my 36-year-old self right now, and he'd enjoy the hell out of life. He'd enjoy being able to walk across the street and jump up the curb, mm-hmm. which is something I lost for a little while. That's mm-hmm. something, there's small things in life people take for granted. Mm-hmm. You ever been walking the street and a car comes and you kind of like walk a little bit faster and jump up the curb?
Right.
A lot of people can't do that.
Yeah.
A lot of people can't get off the toilet normally. A lot of people can't get out of the car without pain. Mm-hmm. So looking at the bigger picture of functionality of life, to be able to say an active good father and husband and friend, all that stuff, look at it globally and what is what I'm doing just for me, or is it also for other people? Mm-hmm. And so me being functional and healthy is better, not just for me, but for my family, my future family at the time I was thinking about.
Right.
And that's it. You know, it's not that serious and it's not that important, mm-hmm. but being good at life is.
Wow. Good stuff, man. So where did the functional fitness stuff come into the picture? When did you start with CrossFit and those kind of things?
It started indirectly in the early 2000s for me when I was training football stuff, mm-hmm. doing interval training and more like the plyometrics, power cleans, squatting, and then doing it in bursts. I thought, you know, why am I going to sit here, stand around and work for a couple seconds and rest, work for a couple seconds and rest? And the functionality of it was fast work, mm-hmm. rest for 30 seconds or so in the huddle. And so that's how I started training. And then after college, I moved back to LA and I started doing the typical bodybuilding, like Tuesdays arms and back, mm-hmm. and breaking it up and doing stuff like that. But then again, I got bored. I was like, okay, I'm going to do 3 sets of 10 of this. But like in between sets, what am I doing? I'm standing around at the gym, mm-hmm. doing nothing. And I was like, well, why don't I utilize this time? And so in between those, I started mixing in the gymnastic element of CrossFit, which I didn't know at the time. So I would do pull-ups and push-ups or whatever I was working on. I was doing a bodyweight movement in between. Mm-hmm. And I was also running to and from the gym. And I thought it was kind of weird. And I was like, why am I going to drive, park as close as I can,
right,
take the escalator up? And so I started getting more bang for my buck that way, running, mm-hmm. and then doing, I was already warm when I got there, and I do my thing and I leave. And then in about 2004, 2005, I started, at the time I didn't know exactly what I wanted to do with my life. I had some ideas, but it wasn't clear to me yet. Mm-hmm. But I was good at training people, and I liked fitness, and I liked nutrition a lot. And so natural progression was, well, let me do what I have a passion for, and which was fitness, or still is, but which at the time was fitness and nutrition. So I started training people. Mm-hmm. And I ended up starting a business that at the park, and it was a square workout. And tell me if this sounds familiar. So I would set up cones about 10 yards apart from each other in the shape of a square. Mm-hmm. One side was an upper body movement. One was a lower body. One was a core movement, and one was full body. Mm-hmm. Each station lasted a minute, and it was trying to get as many reps as you could in that minute, mm-hmm. right? So it might be a minute's worth of push-ups. You go to the other side of the square, a minute of squats, the other side, a minute of sit-ups, and the other side, a minute of burpees. Mm-hmm. And then I had a rest a minute. That's had it built in. And so the plan was to do that 5 times, depending on the crowd I had, or 4 times, depending on the fitness level. And each time they went around the square, it was a different movement. Mm-hmm. So instead of sit-ups, they might be planking for that minute.
Yep.
Or instead of squats, they were lunging. And that right there, my square, that was my business right there. Mm-hmm. And that's how I made money for a while. And that was, obviously, it's very similar to Fight Gone Bad, yep. or some of these other AMRAPs, 1 minute AMRAPs in CrossFit.
Yep.
And so a friend of mine from work said, hey, you should check out CrossFit. And my buddy, his name is Andy Rios. He actually now owns CrossFit Simi Valley, CrossFit Simi. Mm-hmm. He also happens to be the regional director for the California regionals now. Mm-hmm. With SoCal, he's done the last few years. But he has a background in the Navy, and that's where he picked up on it. He's a reserve at the time, but he's a 20-year vet of Navy SEALs. And so that's where he had learned, and he shared it with me. Mm-hmm. And then that is in the early part of my law enforcement career, when he told me about that.
Mm-hmm. So you were doing the park workout business while you were doing law enforcement?
Yeah. So the gap, to bridge that gap, the passion for fitness was there. But I got somewhat tired and worried about the future of just standing and counting people's reps. Mm-hmm. I can only count to 10 so many times. I can cheer. And I felt like that had a ceiling, and I started thinking about family. I started thinking about retirement. I started thinking about insurance. I started thinking about secure job, because with that, in the holidays, you know, you always take a hit money-wise. Yep. And so it's not really a dependable career for me. And when I was in college, I started looking at, like, sports psychology. I started looking at chiropractic school, even sports agent stuff. But then one that kept coming back was law enforcement. It was like U.S. Marshals or FBI stuff. But with those, the government stuff, they didn't make as much money as some of the municipality police departments. Mm-hmm. And I didn't get to control exactly where I would end up living. Mm-hmm. And to have a family, you want to have stability and be in one place.
Yeah.
And so it dawned on me that I guess I always wanted to be a police officer. And most people think of police, you know, everyone has their own, like, right now, as I'm saying, probably thinking how they feel about police officers. But there's a couple of things that stood out to me as far as that job goes. Number one, I get to be outside. Mm-hmm. I'm not stuck behind a desk for ever and ever and ever. You get to train in a lot of different things. So something that my fitness or physicality would play a part. Not many people have a job where they can train for. Mm-hmm. You can work out, you know, to fight sitting down at your desk too long, but my fitness level possibly has saved me in my career so far. And something that common sense was a really big part of, and mediation. Police officers, I always say, is like they're kind of like common sense appliers. Mm-hmm. Wherever we're going, generally we're going there to apply common sense to help problem solve and mediate. Mm-hmm. And the other big component was I grew up being part of a team, and I missed the camaraderie. Mm-hmm. And I wanted the locker room feeling. I missed wearing a uniform. I miss gear. And so in a weird way, law enforcement was almost an extension of football for me.
Interesting.
And you're a professional good guy. I use a hashtag sometimes. It's on my social media stuff, but that's why I wanted to be a professional good guy.
Nice.
You know?
Yeah.
So it was a natural progression.
Very cool. So now, how long have you been in law enforcement at this point? And what is your, if you can say, like, your rank or your position at this point?
Yeah, I'm coming up on 10 years, and I'm an officer right now, looking forward to promoting to sergeant one of these days, hopefully sooner than later. And I have been part of our SWAT team for 8 years.
Wow. So is the SWAT team something that you only do at certain times, like when it's needed, and the other time you're kind of, for lack of better words, like a regular cop? Is that how that works?
Yes. So we're full-time, part-time is one way to look at it.
Okay.
Some of my department is just over 200 officers. So we're not LAPD or the sheriff's department with 10,000 officers and a lot of land to cover. So they can afford a full-time team because a lot of work and that much geography. My department is, like I said, over like 215 officers or so in about 8 square miles. And so we don't have work all the time. Mm-hmm. And so there's guys on my team that are detectives, that are field training officers, that are bicycle officers, motorcycle officers. So it's a very collective group, but we train together every other week. And we do work as it comes up, whether serving warrants or responding to call-outs. Mm-hmm. So just because it's a part-time, we're essentially always on call, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Got it. Yeah, so I was going to ask kind of what the steps were to that career path, but you sort of answered it when you were talking about, you know, wanting that camaraderie, wanting that uniform, and that kind of feeling like a part of a group. Do you think that is kind of something that was more ingrained in you as a person, or do you think that is a, you know, the nature versus nurture type of thing where it came directly from you always being on those teams and kind of wanting, maybe not a great word to use, but a nostalgia in a way?
Mm-hmm.
Can you answer that?
I definitely think being part of a team changes a person.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, even the way guys tease each other, guys that grew up on team, the way we show affection and appreciation, love for each other, we tease each other a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes I've seen guys that grew up maybe not being part of a team sometimes don't have that same personality trait.
Mm-hmm.
I could be wrong, but that's just my observations. But it's not just, I don't think it's just that. I think, I don't know really where to pinpoint it, whether it's family or the team sports. You know, I can't speak for all the other people that end up doing that career. Some people grow up knowing that they want to be a policeman since they were a kid.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody in my family is in law enforcement. I was not exposed. I didn't have any friends that were involved in it. It wasn't something that was around me, right? Or maybe I would have joined sooner. Same thing about the military. You know, I wasn't surrounded by that. I was surrounded by athletes and school. Mm-hmm. And those are the two things I took seriously. So
what did you end up studying in college? You mentioned
psychology.
Okay.
Yeah, I picked psychology because it was broad and I thought I can go get a master's degree in anything after that.
Mm-hmm.
But I also want to point out that I grew up liking Batman. I grew up liking Superman. I grew up liking comic book heroes. And so that's where I joke around about being a professional good guy. Because,
mm-hmm.
yeah, they're superheroes, yes, but there's the closest thing that you can think of to Batman are police officers.
Mm-hmm.
And right behind me, you see, I got a Batman cape over there.
Nice.
You can't see, I got a Batman mask in my locker. But I think that's part of the psychology that grew in me.
Yeah. Yeah.
And they're out there in helping people and, you know, trying to take away bad guys.
Yeah. Cool. So kind of on the niche part of your job of the SWAT team, I assume that could produce some pretty interesting stories. Are you willing to share any kind of, I don't know, for lack of a better word, an exciting day of work on the SWAT team?
Well, yes. Yeah. I'll try not to get too specific, but I can tell you one thing. It's not as glamorous as it seems to be.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the time we're in our gear. It's heavy. It's uncomfortable. It's hot. And we're in it for a long period of time.
Mm-hmm.
It's a lot of standing around.
Mm-hmm.
I can think of one recently. It was a hostage thing. It was a call out. Someone ran out of a house, just broke free from being tied up by a family member, and flagged down a neighbor. Hey, you know, I just broke free. This person had me hostage, and my grandma's still in there. So, of course, we set up a perimeter there, and then we got the call. Now, we get there, hurry up to get there, right? We get there, and literally it was 12 hours, and we're standing around, and it was the middle of winter.
Wow.
And so something like that, it's like, oh, cool. But then you end up, because there's negotiations that happen.
Right. It's not just show up and bust in and get the job done and get out of there.
No, you know, well, not, usually not.
Yeah.
Usually not, because when, at least the way my team works, and I always say, I believe that my team and a lot of teams in Los Angeles are very intellectual.
Mm-hmm.
And I say that because we're not the macho team. We're the smart team. Because if we rush in there, what is that going to do? It's going to put us at risk, and it could put somebody else at risk, and it could put bad guy or bad guys at risk,
mm-hmm.
into a violent situation that we could possibly avoid.
Mm-hmm.
And so we end up, in this case, long story short, he, through negotiations with our crisis negotiation team, he ended up releasing the second hostage and then stayed inside, and we were outside, and then we started shooting gas into the house, these little ferret rounds through the windows,
mm-hmm.
trying to get him to come out. Because we're not going to go, I mean, you don't go into his home court, right? So we tried to get him to come out. And unfortunately, that went on for hours and hours and hours. And we used a robot to go in and spy, and long poles with cameras and all kinds of stuff. And unfortunately, in this case, he ended up taking his own life. Oh, wow. But we didn't know that until much later because we couldn't hear it. Mm-hmm. But that's one story.
Yeah.
Now, why it might sound, I don't know if that's exciting or not.
it's interesting. I mean, that's all we're looking for.
So a lot of times it's warrants. So another example would be if some guy comes and commits an armed robbery or some type of violent felony in our city. Detectives do amazing work and they find out who it is, and then they give us all the information and say, hey, this person needs to be arrested. Mm-hmm. He lives here. So we'll go out and scout it out, see what the house looks like, and we're in plain clothes, mm-hmm. look like everybody else. Scout it out, see what's going on, look at the layout, and come up with a plan to come to his house, generally in the middle of the night, mm-hmm. and when the rapid eye movement sleep is kicking in, mm-hmm. and try and take the bad guy into custody without any harm.
Yep.
So you see all this, the vest, you see the armored vehicles, you know, in the media, mm-hmm. you see shields, you see helmets, you see all this stuff that people tend to think is, oh my gosh, the police are becoming the military, mm-hmm. and freaking out. All that stuff that you see is defensive stuff.
Right.
It's just protection for us. It's just extra padding and shields so we don't get hurt.
Yep.
None of it's offensive. And so that's where we're decked out in stuff that protects us. Granted, we're armed, yeah, but we're trying not to use that stuff.
Yeah.
In my opinion, I'd rather not be in that position in the first place if that person didn't do what he did in the first, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
I'd rather just say, hey, man, how you doing? Instead of here to arrest you.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Hey, man, be good, raise your family, have a good life.
Yeah. So kind of last question, that's a loaded one, pardon the pun, for the law enforcement, is I have to ask, and there's no other way to ask it, so I'll just be blunt.
Yeah.
Have you had to take someone's life?
No. I'm hoping I don't have to.
Yeah.
It's not something that most of us really become the professional good guy role to do.
Right.
I've come close a few times, mm-hmm. but I like to use I like to use the tools I have. I like to use my height. I like to use my uniform appearance. I mm-hmm. like to use the appearance of my fitness to mm-hmm. and to be friendly. Mm-hmm. And because I think it's easy to force yourself into a bad situation if that's what you're looking for.
Yeah. Is there anything within the law enforcement or your organizations that helps officers deal with that kind of mental aspect of if and when they do have to take someone's life? Is there counseling or support groups? Or, I mean, I assume that would be pretty difficult. And maybe a follow-up question is, even the time that you've come close, has that weighed on you just knowing that you were that close to that type of situation?
The first thing I thought of when you were saying that is that type of violent encounters are so few and far between. Mm-hmm. I know it happens. If it does happen, it gets, I would say, a small fraction of it even makes the media, but it's not something that is very common.
Yeah.
I forget the stat, but it's like 99% of law enforcement don't get involved in a shooting. Mm-hmm. I can say this, though, is that I feel very well prepared for it if I have to, mm-hmm. as far as skill goes. Mm-hmm. So as far as my proficiency with my tools, mm-hmm. proficiency in my staying calm, fitness levels, ability to handle stress, mm-hmm. all that stuff is something that I think my department does a great job of. Now, after the fact, there's steps that guys go through. There's mm-hmm. mandatory steps and counseling mm-hmm. and days mm-hmm. off and stuff like that. Anything that's there, we're very supportive of people.
It's cool.
Yeah, for sure. Yep. But it's the same thing about anything. They don't necessarily have to be in a shooting. Mm-hmm. We have a tremendous peer support group. If guys are having problems at home or whatever, any kind of stress, mm-hmm. help is there. The hard part is, identifying it on someone becomes before it explodes, and trying to get this person help. And that's not just police, that's in anything.
Yeah.
So it's all there. We're not necessarily any different. We handle stress. It's part of our job.
Yeah.
Some people do it better than others. Those violent situations aren't necessarily what stresses me out, because essentially that's what we train for.
Right.
It's the other stuff that you don't ask for. It's the hurt kids. Mm-hmm. There's some terrible stories there. And another thing to point out as far as this career is that, you know, we see the worst parts of human behavior.
Yeah.
It's not like, oh, Billy just turned 13. Yay, let's have a party. Okay, wait, call 911. Let's get him over here. You know, it's not like that. Mm-hmm. It's all the bad stuff that you can think of, no matter what your imagination can think of. And then that's what we go to.
Right. Yeah. I had the opportunity last year to go on a ride along with Chad Augustine, who is a grid athlete and a CrossFit Games Masters athlete.
He's been involved in CrossFit for a long time.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. So I did a video with him for one of his supplement sponsors, Metrics, and I got to do a ride along in his life flight helicopter and in the fire truck, because he's a life flight medic and a fireman. And he was kind of saying some of the same things as far as, like, you just see the bad people and the kids, like, really breaks his heart and stuff, because you go to these call outs that, you know, these kids just are in really terrible situations that they didn't ask for and they can't control. And I can definitely see, especially, you know, you being a family man and having kids now of yourself and everything, how that can be super difficult to watch and see firsthand.
Absolutely. That's easily the worst part.
Yeah. So we're going to switch gears a little bit and talk about the Wodcast podcast, which, as I mentioned before, you're the co-host of. And you kind of touched on in an earlier comment about how you got involved, you know, a couple episodes in, and you were a listener first. So tell me the beginning of that and sort of how you got involved with the podcast.
So the beginning was hosted by three guys. One of them left. I know all of them. Let me just back up. I know all the guys.
Mm-hmm. And you knew them before they started the podcast?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. And who were those original
that
three?
That is Eddie F., Kenny Kane, and Armin Hammer.
Yep.
And Kenny Kane, who kind of had the role that I have now in the sense of booking guests and building content and stuff like that. So Kenny had talked to me about coming on, and the role I had for the show as a guest was implementing CrossFit into SWAT, or CrossFit into law enforcement, and how CrossFit has helped me as a police officer. Okay. How it helps police departments, and which has grown already, because when I was on the show, I think it was probably 3 years ago now, as that guest, and that was something we talked about, and that was the hat I wore the couple times I went on. Then when Eddie would travel, because he's a professional comedian, he travels around all the time, all over the country and the world. When he was gone, I started coming on as a guest host. So I guest hosted about 10 times or so. And then when Kenny Kane ended up leaving the show, it was just naturally, I just came in and kind of just started running with it. So, and here we are now, 180 something episodes in.
Yeah. So can you describe everyone's role in the show, and maybe there's kind of a quote unquote official role, and maybe kind of your version or your outlook on what roles people are?
Yeah. I've always wondered, I've almost thought about posting that question and asking the listeners, hey, what do you guys think our roles are? I'm just curious, you know, but so I came on and I get the guests, I control that, I schedule the shows, not all the guests, but majority. And I'm almost like the responsible parent of the show, you know, and I get them, we schedule it. We generally have the same time, but it fluctuates during the week, but getting everybody there, making sure everyone can make it on time, adjusting if need be, doing social media stuff. I started the Instagram and getting all the content for that. And a lot of the behind the scenes stuff. I do hand signals during the show. I'd pass notes. So if not, who knows where the show would go? Because sometimes we start talking and my boy Eddie he's the professional talker. He has a story for everything.
Yep.
And I think he's done everything except bobsledding. But he's done so much in his life that he tells great stories.
Right.
And so that reminds me, I want to have Eddie actually on as a guest on our show.
Okay.
But that's in the future. But so I keep track of the show because we have these guests that come on and they have stuff they want to plug and stories and stuff that I'm interested in asking them.
Right.
And sometimes we have some pretty big names on the show.
Yep.
And so I want to make sure that they get their part in, and as do we. And so I'm paying attention to the time and making sure to include them as much as we can. Because it could very easily be a guestless show. Like it could be Armin and I and Eddie. But that would probably get old pretty quickly. And then Armin. So Eddie is the comedian, and he comes in, and he brings the stories. He brings content. He brings energy into the show. I mean, he's been involved in that stuff for decades. And then Armin is the youngest of the group. Most people don't know he's now 26, but when we started the show, he was like 23 years old. And he is super intelligent. I don't know if people really give him credit for that too much because of all the dick jokes, but he is, he got started on the show because he did a blog called The Naked CrossFitter. And that was something that was hilarious in my opinion. Because I don't take things very seriously. And he would call out the silly stuff. The stuff the stuff that was going on, he would blog about it, talk about it, make fun of it. And it doesn't matter, even stuff in CrossFit. You have to be able to look at stuff and make fun of it.
Yeah.
And so that's what he was doing in a blog. And that caught Eddie's attention when Eddie wanted to start a CrossFit-based podcast. And so the two of them started and then brought in Kenny. So Armin is an encyclopedia of CrossFit knowledge. I mean, if we want to talk about the games workout from 2009 on the second day, he probably knows what it is.
Right.
So he's like our, I don't want to say he's like our, stat boy is not the right word, but he's like a CrossFit Google. And he also knows a lot about strongman. He knows a lot about Olympic weightlifting. And he also has experience running a gym and coaching. He's probably our most experienced, not probably, he's our most experienced coach on the show. Although he doesn't have that role on the show. And he's very personable. You know, he's great on the show. And so then there's me. I'm not sure what I do except keep it organized.
Yeah.
And then bring in some good one-liners hopefully every now and then.
Yeah, I was going to say you do seem like a bit of a kind of play the role of the leader of the show. That comes across. And so my follow-up question, which I guess you kind of answered, was, you know, was that something that was deliberate of, you know, when you came on, they were like, okay, you're going to be the one that books the guests and keeps it organized and this, that, and the other. Or was that kind of just, you know, a natural thing that everybody just fell into their roles?
No, definitely. They were, it was not spoken about ever. It was something that I felt as a, remember, as a listener, as a guest, something that needed to be done to help the show as a fan of the show. So what can I do to help the show and how would I want it and what other benefits can I see and how can we grow it and how can that also be monetized? And so organizing it, coming up with a structure, this whiteboard behind you here, we used to record here out of my garage, which I call Studio South, but I would write on the whiteboard a structure for the show. And if it started getting off track, I'd kind of like point at one of them and then draw it back in. So we had some structure and got through content because I didn't like when we would do shows and have a certain guest and then totally forget to talk about something really important.
Right.
And so need the organization. So where I'm the organization and structure, Eddie is like the chaos and Armin's the cute guy that brings up all the knowledge.
Awesome. I love it, man.
Hopefully, I don't know if that's how it comes off, but that's my precision.
I think that is how it comes off, but it's cool to hear your perspective on that. So I think that's really cool to discuss. So obviously you're a fan of CrossFit and you were when you started the show. At this point, now that you're a few years into doing this show, does kind of keeping up with the industry and what's going on and keeping up with the guests and everything, does that ever feel like a job at this point or is it still kind of, you know, just fun and games?
Yes. Yes, it does. I like to do, especially when I know the guest is, who the guest is, I'll definitely do some homework.
Yeah.
Because I don't want to come there and then not know who they are.
Yeah.
Or not bring up stuff. I mean, it's something that I feel is the right thing to do for the guest. Because they're going to come on and be like, so what do you do again?
Right.
Like, oh, you're really like, what show do you do? You know, like Bob Harper, he came on the show for episode 100 from The Biggest Loser. And I had never seen an episode of The Biggest Loser. And it's like, here's Bob Harper. I know he's a he must be somebody. He's a somebody, but I had no knowledge of him.
Right.
And so I watched some YouTube videos, did some research.
Yep.
So each guest, I do that type of stuff. A lot of times I take notes and little buzzwords and stuff that I want to ask them. A lot of them I don't have to. If I have personal relationships with them, it's even better. But even still, I'll still do a little bit of research. But You know, it's like there's a lot of stuff that goes on now. CrossFit as a community has become, I don't want to say a soap opera, but there's always some drama.
Yeah.
I'm still waiting for the legitimate CrossFit TMZ site to pop up, where if you guys don't know what TMZ is, it's all the celebrity gossip and news.
Yeah.
And I'm waiting for the CrossFit version to pop up. We used to have a segment called CFZ on the Wodcast where I would kind of bring up some of that stuff, but that got to be too much work. But yes, I do my homework. Yes, I pay attention. Yes, I'll go to the main site. I'll go and read what's going on the internets and the Facebooks and the Instagrams, because I want to be able to drive the show.
Yeah. So does that end up feeling like work to you? I mean, does that bog you down? Do you like set a time, certain times for it? Or is it just kind of still enjoyable at this point?
Well, it is definitely is enjoyable. Because if I wasn't enjoying it, I wouldn't be doing it.
Mm-hmm.
Time is sensitive for me, between work and family and two kids and a new kid. So to do something like that I don't enjoy, I follow my passions.
Yeah.
So I'm passionate about it. I love talking to people about it. I love interviewing the guests and having a great time with the guys. And I love CrossFit so much that it's awesome that I'm in that opportunity to be able to do that.
Yeah.
So I don't want to like throw that away. I want to do as well as I can at that for the listeners.
Mm-hmm.
But occasionally it does feel like work.
Yeah.
So if I have to go and I'll actually do a lot of it when I'm eating.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm sitting down, I like to multitask. It's hard for me to do one thing at a time. So if I'm sitting down and I have a free hand, I'm on the internet reading.
Yeah.
That's usually when I'll do some studying.
Okay, interesting. Yeah. And part of the reason I ask is because I'm now close to 30 episodes into my show here, and a lot of it feels like work, you know?
Yep.
Pinning down the guests and trying to figure out the best way to sort of batch do interviews, you know, whether that be the actual interviews or setting up for the interviews, writing the questions out, you know, making the posts afterwards, it becomes quite a bit of work.
It's tough. It's tough, especially... And it's just you.
Yeah.
So, you know, on the Wodcast, I have me and I got the two other hosts. I have Machete, our sound guy.
Yeah.
Make sure he can do it because he's like the most popular podcast sound engineer in the world. And then the guest. And a lot of times the guests come from out of town. So juggling that part.
Right.
And then juggling sponsors as well.
Yeah.
We have like roughly 5 sponsors per show.
Mm-hmm.
Making sure that I'm doing the right sponsor for the right episode,
mm-hmm.
and then doing the invoices for all that stuff.
Yeah.
On top of that, doing all the social media stuff, coming up with the content for that, and then making sure you're staying on track with that and all the comments that are coming in.
Yeah. It's a lot. It's a lot going on.
So that when you start doing all that stuff, it's like it's work.
Yeah.
But I'm so passionate and happy to be doing it. That's where it doesn't feel like work.
Right. Got it. So you just brought up the sponsors and stuff, and you've told me before that you kind of take care of that. So as a group, you know, the three hosts, do you guys view the podcast as a business and sort of treat it that way? Or is it, obviously it's a passion project, but do you also look at it as a business and sort of talk about things as a business?
Not really. The goal is to monetize it for a while, because we went for a long time where we were just paying for the show out of pocket.
Yeah.
Paying for the hosting on the site and paying for Machete to come and do his wizardry.
Mm-hmm.
But then it got to a certain point where like, hey, this is silly. We're doing all this and let's start figuring out ways to monetize it. And we started looking maybe at start selling them, you know, 99 cents an episode,
mm-hmm.
or doing a couple free ones and then a special episode for 99 cents, mm-hmm. stuff like that. But there was some part about having it stay the same and offering something we've been doing for free to the listeners and to keep it that way.
Yeah.
You know, it's like the listeners are there to support us and to listen and have a good time with us. So they're kind of our friends.
Yeah.
So why do we want to take it away from them?
Mm-hmm.
And so not that we're taking anything away, you know, it's still beneficial for sponsors to come on the show and beneficial for that stuff. But it became something that, sponsors became interested in. We built it up enough,
right,
where it became something like, hey, can we get on? Can we sponsor your show? And then it's at the point now where we're selective on who we allow to be on our show.
Cool.
Which is cool. And we keep long relationships with people that we like.
Yeah. So I'd love to dig into the business end of things just because that's sort of how I'm wired, kind of entrepreneurial and stuff. So I don't want to get, you know, too much in your business or anything, but I'm curious, you know, you do seem to take that leader role. You book the guests, you, you know, work with the sponsors. So how do you guys break up that money that comes in for the sponsors? Is it a certain amount, like earmarked for each person, percentage? How does that work?
Well, so first of all, there's no mathematical equation or precedence really in what to charge for ads on a podcast. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure you've probably been doing some research on that and stuff like that. It's not like, oh, if you have, you know, 10,000 listeners per episode, this is what you charge for a 30-second commercial.
Right.
It's not like that. It also depends on the type of podcast you have. And for us, part of the benefit for our show is that our listeners are like our friends, and they believe in what we say. Mm-hmm. And so we want to support something that is good, and we don't want to lose our credibility. Mm-hmm. You know, something that's really important to me. So the price that we end up coming up with is based on some research, and it's gone up. It used to be a lot lower than it is now. Now our show has grown and grown and grown. The price per episode, per read, goes up. Mm-hmm. Now, there's still not an exact equation. Some of those numbers I come up with, mm-hmm. and I sell it. And be like, hey, you know, I like you guys. This is what you support us. We negotiate a price. That's something good for both of us. And so the most of them range anywhere from, I would say, $200 to $500. Mm-hmm. And depending on the placement in the show and how long the reads go, mm-hmm. and how long the length of commitment.
Yeah. And now once those dollars come in between the hosts, do you guys take a certain percentage out as, you know, your payment or your salary, so to speak?
So there's generally, depending on who got the read, we'll get a percent commission. Mm-hmm. Eddie and Armin are the owners of the show.
Okay.
Because they were there in the very beginning and started it. And so I'm almost like a independent contractor, mm-hmm. sort of, is kind of the way we're looking at it. And I get a commission off of that stuff. Mm-hmm. And then a producer fee is kind of the way our stuff is set up. And what they do with money after that is up to them. There's still stuff for the show and taxes and other fees.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Cool. Okay. Well, thanks for sharing that. Once again, we're going to switch gears, and we've got a little bit of time left. I want to talk about your family a little bit. Recently, you've been posting on social media about your newest child. So congratulations on birth. Connor, is that his name? Is that right?
Yes. Yeah, Connor.
Go ahead and tell me a little bit about the struggles that you guys faced. And, you know, I'll let you get kind of as deep as you want here. But I know that, you know, you were posting on social media and a lot of people were being very supportive. Mm-hmm. And it seemed like after you saw that support, you kind of opened up a little bit more. So fill in some of those details for us.
Well, the social media thing in general has been a slow roll for me. Mm-hmm. And I say that because for a long time I was just involved in law enforcement and very protective of my privacy.
Yeah.
So I was hesitant for social media stuff or certain posts for a long time. And then I started doing the Wodcast, and I would talk about my career, and I was using my name. And so it kind of, and I was doing stuff for HQ. I was doing CrossFit. I did a CrossFit seminar for HQ on implementing CrossFit into SWAT teams. Mm. My team was involved in, you know, we were on 3 different CrossFit Journal videos about us doing CrossFit or us doing Murph as mm-hmm. our qualifier for the team. So like my face and name in law enforcement started getting out into the public. So I was like, okay, I'm not going to have a huge career in like narcotics or anything where I'm undercover.
But, right.
And so that started lightening me up a little bit as far as the stuff I would put out. Mm-hmm. I started thinking about, obviously people, you know, aren't going to like police officers, but I don't think I carry myself in a way that I create enemies, if that makes sense. Yeah. Even the bad guys that I've dealt with, I still, you know, will treat them with respect. You know, I don't know what they're going through or why they're doing what they're doing, but my goal is not to always, like I said, if I could like high five and like share coffee with the guy, I'd rather be doing that than be put in a position where I have to arrest him.
Right.
So, it's in a supportive way. Sometimes it can be heavy-handed. There are bad guys. We have to do bad things. Some, not bad things, but unfortunate things where you, if it gets physical, you know, that sometimes it comes to that. You know, mm-hmm. Police work isn't always pretty. But I'm not doing things where I'm going to create enemies. So I lightened up a little bit. The stuff about my family, so I'm not, you know, most people probably don't know. So I have a two, almost three, in a couple months, he'll be three. And his name is Caden. Kid number two comes around. Mm-hmm. She's 20 weeks pregnant. We get a test done, and her antibodies for one thing were high. And it was one of those tests where they're like, hey, you know, we're going to take some blood, but don't worry, we're not going to call you unless there's something wrong. Mm-hmm. One of those. So she gets a call and freaks out, of course. They leave a message, and then she calls back, and they just left the office. Next thing you know, it's the weekend. And we're like, oh, crap. So antibodies were high, and we end up going in. It turns out she had a KEL antibody. Now, this is the part where it gets confusing. So I'm KEL positive, turns out. And KEL is essentially something that's on the surface of a red blood cell. So I might have like a little satellite piece sticking off my red blood cell. Mm-hmm. I'm fine. Doesn't affect me. Most people are KEL negative. It's a small percentage of the population that are positive. So I have a positive and a negative for it. And it has nothing to do with your blood type. I'm O positive, but it has nothing to do with that. So I'm KEL positive, negative. And so when I have a kid, it's 50-50 chance of them getting a positive or a negative. So baby one gets the positive. So you have a KEL positive baby in a negative environment. Mom. Mm-hmm. We don't know. Maybe during birth, at some point in time, some of baby one's blood got into mom's blood. Just like a flu shot. Now, her mom's immune system built up an antibody. Here's this foreign stuff in. We have to now form an antibody to attack it. So now she's sensitized to that. Baby two gets KEL positive. So now baby two is going into an environment that is armed and ready for his blood. Mm-hmm. So it was something we monitored for a little while. And then all of a sudden, he became severely anemic fast. So her antibodies were attacking baby two's antibodies when she was pregnant, attacking his red blood cells, destroying them, and destroying his ability to create red blood cells. Mm. So that's all bad stuff. So,
and they can tell all this while he's still inside.
Yeah, these ultrasounds. Wow. And so there's a tiny little vein that at the time when your fetus is actually like in the brain that they can check the blood flow. Mm-hmm. It's crazy. I don't know where it ends up once you're born or where, but when they're looking at it, they're looking at your brain, the little vein, I forget what it's called, and they could see there. So he became severely anemic and started getting swelling, what's called high drops, which are very fatal for babies or for fetuses. So he started to get swelling in his abdomen. He had swelling in between his scalp and his skull. His heart was enlarged to like 2/3 of his body because it was having to work so hard because he was so anemic. When we ended up getting the first surgery, back it up. So this is where we start to freak out.
Yeah.
And at this point in time, nobody knows about it. So nothing on social media, nothing. And it's like, okay, well, what do we do about it? And they send us to like a super, super special doctor who does intrauterine fetal blood transfusions. So while the baby is inside the womb, he can do a blood transfusion to that baby. And so we went and saw him. He happens to be like 45 minutes away in Hollywood. If he wasn't there, we would be traveling back and forth to Florida.
Wow.
So luckily he's 45 minutes away. Yeah. People travel from Hawaii, from Colorado to go see him. So we go, he sees how anemic the baby is, and we get surgery booked like immediately. Mm-hmm. So the first surgery, mom goes in there and it's full blown, like surgery. She gets the whole procedure.
Yeah.
And so the way they do it, they end up taking the needle and it goes into the umbilical vein. Doesn't actually go into the baby. It goes into a little vein in the umbilical cord. Mm-hmm. That's what's crazy about this. Wow. And he does it all through ultrasound. And so he did that, and he did a small transfusion the first time. And the baby's blood was like water, he said. Legitimately, the water. is almost clear because the hemoglobin was at a 2. Normally, it's like 14 to 18. Mm-hmm. We thought driving to the hospital and the day prior that he was dead. We thought because she hadn't felt him kick or move.
Wow.
And so we're sitting there, you know, I don't think my mouth closed. It was just my jaw was just like droopy. We were sad because we decided to go this route. So we go, we do the surgery the first day, and we're still really worried. And we're worried because the doctor's like, you know, I can only do part of it because we're worried that the baby's heart is going to explode. He's going to have a heart attack mm-hmm. from the blood transfusion. So we're like, okay, so we were going to come back the next week. And at the time, during all this, I'm studying, going through a sergeant assessment procedure for my department, which is very, very competitive and stressful. Mm-hmm. So we go, we get done, we go home, we're sitting on the couch. There's like, I don't know, maybe a cushion between us. The TV's on, but it's like one of those things where you just get the worst news ever. And there's stuff going on around you, but you're not paying attention to the TV. You're just kind of off staring in the distance. Mm-hmm. Your mouth is loose. Like you're daydreaming, like thinking about who knows what. I don't even know what I was thinking. We were just sitting, staring and like not blinking with a blank slate on our face. And then all of a sudden she quickly reached over and grabs my wrist. My wife does. And yanks it over to her belly. And I look over at her and she has this like full of life look in her eye. And she's pressing my hand against her stomach. And next thing you know, I feel a full-on front kick. Mm. Boom, right into my hand. And it was the first time I ever felt him move.
Yeah.
At all, even kick at all. Mm-hmm. And so I get this, boom, just a kick right into my hand. And it fired me up. I'm like, you know what? Like, he's in here fighting his ass off. Mm-hmm. But I'm going to say, that's it. I'm not going to feel sorry for us. Let's go. We're going to defeat this thing. It doesn't matter if we're doing 10 surgeries, 10 transfusions. He's in it. He's kicking away. He's saying, let's fight. Mm-hmm. Let's go. Boom.
Wow.
And so that's why I say it's like already before he's born, he's like motivating me.
Yeah.
Because like, it doesn't matter how difficult it is. You just got to keep fighting, keep going, keep driving, keep moving forward. Like adversity is, you can't avoid it. But what you do when you're faced with it is what defines you.
Yeah.
And here he is already, just a little, you know, little warrior, you know, full of strong will.
Yeah.
And that fired us up. Next thing you know, since then we've been through, before she gave birth, she had five surgeries. So we have 5 blood transfusions. She was in the hospital for 3 weeks prior to the birth, which is, I mean, so many things happen with the pregnancy. I don't know how much time we have for this, but another thing, while we're monitoring the vein in his head for this blood issue, mm-hmm. the doctor checked the checked the placenta and saw that one of the placenta veins was too close to the cervical opening, and it's called vasa previa. Placenta previa is a common thing. Hopefully someone listening knows what I'm talking about, but that's when placenta moves down too low and blocks the cervical opening, essentially like plugging the hole. Mm-hmm. Well, as one of the veins did that. This is something that's like 1 in 5,000 chance. That vein where it was scared the doctors. So if her water were to break or she were to go into labor, that vein could have been severed and then the baby would bleed out in under 3 minutes. Mm. So we had that thing going as well. So the crazy part is if that blood thing didn't happen, we might not ever have known about the vein issue.
Right.
So we might have gone all the way like a normal pregnancy, and then at birth, her water broke. The baby could have bled out at home. Mm-hmm. But because of this blood issue, it pointed that thing out, and that's why we took him out early. Mm. It's a whole crazy thing, man. There's been one thing after another. Yeah. He was born with the umbilical cord wrapped around his neck twice. You know, wasn't breathing, wasn't moving, was blue when he was born.
Wow.
And keeps super, super resilient. And through all this and through the motivation and how it made me feel, it was something that I wanted to share mm-hmm. with other people. And that's where some of these posts came up. You know, mm-hmm. It's like, you know what? It's time for me. I feel confident, happy, and open. And we've been receiving support from everybody that knows about this. Let's open up and start updating people.
Yeah. Wow. Very cool. So we are running a little bit low on time, but
I'm curious as to your mindset throughout all this, and I love the part of when, you know, he kicked in and fired you up and everything. Knowing that you come from a high-stress environment like law enforcement, knowing that you've trained CrossFit, which kind of trains the mind in these high-stress situations, do you feel like that kind of stuff played into this high-stress situation?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, there's stuff like that that I'm driven to. I'm also eternally optimistic, which is an annoying trait for my wife to deal with. things happen, all right? So outside of you, there are things that happen in life. You have two choices. You can accept it or resent it. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter what it is. If it's raining outside, I can go and be mad about the rain and grumpy all day, or I can accept it. Hey, look, it's raining. It's cool. All right. Give me a jacket. Mm-hmm. Let me go to the car. Drive a little bit safer. It'll be great. You know, it's cleaning my car. And look at it that way. I can accept it. You get in a car accident. I mean, you get a bad day, traffic. I mean, it doesn't matter what it is. If you actually sit and think, you can accept or resent, and then you choose your path. You choose how you are going to treat that moment in life. It's not up to the event. The event doesn't tell you how to react. The event happens. Mm-hmm. You choose how you're going to feel about it.
Yeah.
And so being aware of that, I don't want to be grumpy and pessimistic and complain about everything. Our time on this planet is short. This is like our Earth is like an amusement park, and I'm going to try and enjoy it as much as I can while I'm here. Mm-hmm. There's too much beauty here to avoid, and there's beauty in the adversity, because it's in those moments that you grow. And so while stuff happens, while this thing is bad, this a really bummer, this thing happened to my kid, but it's bonded my family. It's mm-hmm. made him stronger. It's taught us. It's there's benefits to it. Mm-hmm. And hopefully through some of these posts, inspired some people, or maybe people have gone through the same thing and are drawing hope from that. Mm-hmm. So it boils down to that. I mean, look around. I have this poster over here that says, you know, from Rogue American, you know, I was not delivered into this world in defeat, nor does failure flow through my veins. You know, that's just about resilience. Mm-hmm. So I was being tough about responding to life, because and having broad enough shoulders to deal with what life gives you. And that's something I told my father before he passed, and I tell my mom now. As a kid, I think, as a kid that was raised, I tell them, hey, as parents, I want you to know that I am two things. One, I am happy, and I'm resilient enough to deal with whatever life throws at me. Mm-hmm. I mean, how cool is that? You know, yeah. As a kid, or, I mean, as a friend, I mean, that's what you want people to have.
Yeah.
So that's what I try and lead my life by.
Awesome. I love it, man. Speaking of the stresses of life, you've got the family. I guess let's go ahead and sort of wrap up a Connor story here. So where is he at right now, and what are the steps going forward? Is he out of the clear? Is there ever an out of the clear for him at this point?
So he was born. We've been to the doctor a few times since he was born. At first, we didn't think he was going to need another transfusion, and we were going to take him home the next day. We were like, wow, this is amazing. And then the next day we had a call that his oxygen levels dropped and everything. There was a bunch of some scares. Mm-hmm. But I guess we were thinking too optimistically. And then he ended up getting another transfusion, which was totally expected. Mm-hmm. And so he's going to be monitored every other week or so is what the doctor recommends, because he's pretty stable. Mm-hmm. You get his blood checked and normal stuff. So there's a couple things that we're looking at. As number one, he's like 9 pounds as of today. And he was born at about 5.5 pounds. So he's growing. Mm-hmm. And he's eating, and he's having a lot of wet diapers, which is a good thing.
Right.
So he's peeing and pooping away and staying healthy in that sense. And so it's something that we monitor. Mm-hmm. Out of the clear, I don't think a newborn necessarily is out of the clear for a long time. Mm-hmm. We're worried about the normal newborn stuff, but then the stuff that he went through, we're hoping it's all in the past, and we're going to monitor it. And if we have to get another transfusion or whatever, long term, this is a life speed bump for now. It's a life hurdle. Mm-hmm. But like 6 months to a year from now is when this stuff will all be in a rearview mirror, hopefully.
Right.
Long term issues, we don't know.
Okay.
There might be some developmental delays. Mm-hmm. You know, who knows?
Got it. Okay. So wrapping up the family stuff, we talked about your work, we talked about the podcast, kind of your passions, and now your family. How do you keep a healthy balance in your life with all these things going on?
Well, multitask for one. Move fast. Some stuff had to give, like, you know, I live by the airport, if you guys can all hear that. So some things had to give in life, and so a lot of personal stuff. Like, I would be doing maybe some more kickboxing and jujitsu. Mm-hmm. So some of that stuff had to go by the wayside. The longer workouts in CrossFit, I used to do, like, my strength portion, a skill session, a warm-up, a cool-down, and a WOD, you know, all that stuff. But now it's, like, loosen up a little bit, WOD, mm-hmm. and go. Sleep a little bit less. Mm-hmm. I don't go to the movies like I used to. I don't read, unfortunately, as much as I used to. And some of that stuff has to give mm-hmm. to make room. But it's giving into stuff that I'm happy and passionate about.
Right.
You know, if I don't go see Ant-Man, I think I'll be okay.
Yeah.
You know, so as long as I'm being a good father to my kids, I'm doing well at work, and I'm doing right by the show and the listeners, mm-hmm. and I'm staying, keeping myself well-trained, mm-hmm. it's good to go. There's only three things. I have it up here, if you want to even look. Some of the stuff has on my board that I'm showing fat here on my board is this triangle here. Is the three C's of leadership that I've made up for myself. Mm-hmm. All right. I want to be competent in what I do. That's mm-hmm. the first C. I want to be good at communication, professional and personal. Communication is key. We don't have enough time to not be honest with each other. Mm-hmm. And then my last C is character. If you're good at that stuff, and even cooperation, I would throw in that as well. Mm-hmm. But those together, if I'm good at that stuff, then I think I'll be all right.
Awesome. Cool. So we're going to wind down with a few questions that I call quick hits that I tend to ask all my guests the same questions. First off, how do you decompress?
I have to compress first. And I don't necessarily do that very much. But when I do, part of it is... Sometimes I don't realize it. I say that I didn't realize how much the stuff with Connor was stressing me out until mm-hmm. afterwards. Mm-hmm. So sometimes, like, you ever been in a stinky room, right? You're in a stinky room, but you don't know you're in a stinky room. Yeah. But then you leave for a while.
Every morning as soon as I wake up.
Right? Okay. So you leave for a while, get some fresh air. Let's say you come back in, you're like, dang, it stinks in here.
Yeah.
Well, sometimes that's how stress is.
Yeah.
You don't realize how much of a stinky room you're in until you leave and
yeah, that's a good analogy.
And come back and you're like, dang, I was in a toxic environment.
Right.
So, and funny thing, same thing about nutrition. But if you're eating crappy, then you go out and you stop and you yeah. try to eat crappy again, how much you realize it stinks.
Yeah.
Meditation, key.
What does your meditation practice look like?
Structured, I would try to get 10 minutes of it. That's part of what I started doing here in the garage, mm-hmm. building this into my little man cave. But I'd like to get at least 10 minutes of sitting down quiet. And I say 10 minutes because I don't necessarily, it's not like I set a timer.
Okay.
I have toyed around with the app called Headspace,
yep.
Which I recommend highly if you haven't done meditation before, or even if you have and you lost some of that skill or focus, it helps. Mm-hmm. He actually has a TED talk on it, if you want to look that up, called Headspace.
A TED talk about the app?
It's about the app. It's also about meditation.
Okay.
And, the guy that created it was, like a monk for like 15 years, this Australian guy, super, super, intelligent. And the way he describes why meditation is important and how your thought process works, it's like a no-brainer. We do all this stuff to take care of our bodies. We do all this stuff to take care of our cars, our home. And your mind is the one thing that you use 24 hours a day. Mm-hmm. And so that needs, even though you sleep, your mind is still working a lot. So I don't know. Some people use yoga. Yoga can help to decompress.
Yeah. So for you, when you meditate for, say, 10 minutes or whatever mm-hmm. it might be, is that in the morning, in the evening, in the middle of the day, just whenever you feel like it?
Yeah. So usually in the evening for me.
Okay. And paint me a picture. Where are you at? What are you sitting on? Does that change, or does that kind of stay the same?
Well, here I like to lay down when I do it. Okay. Not always, but that's my ideal position. I like to lay down in an anatomical position. Mm-hmm. So like on my back, palms up. I forget what it's called in yoga. But in that position, and then because I like to let everything relax and get to the point where I feel like my skin is oozing off me. And then really, really to focus on my breathing. And I've toyed around with different breathing techniques, but getting to the point where I like the box breathing. There's a lot of stuff. Mark Divine's really all about the box breathing, if you guys want to look that up. Box breathing is really important, and I use that throughout the whole day. And so even if I'm at work and I'm sitting in a black and white car or sitting in my office, I might take 20 seconds to just regain my composure, go through a couple rounds of my box breathing, and relax. And there's certain parts of your body that you realize are completely under tension that you're doing subconsciously. And most of the time people feel it through their traps, their neck, their face muscles, their feet. You realize how stressed you are by your toes being squeezed or even your hands and how relaxed. So getting a grip on all that stuff throughout the day helps. So it's not necessarily for me just one session and that fixes 10 minutes. Okay, I'm good for the rest of my day. The rest of my day. So it's something I do throughout the entire day, and it's something that keeps me nice and calm in stressful situations.
Cool. Man, I got to get on this. I've probably said it way more times than I should have said it on these podcast episodes. I've been sort of fascinated by the idea of meditation. And one of my, you know, kind of guys that I look up to a lot, Tim Ferriss, always talks about it on his podcast. Earlier this year, I was on vacation in Thailand, listened to Mark Divine's audiobook, Seal Fit. Unbeatable Mind? Yep. Is that the newest one? And, you know, he talked about the box breathing. He talked about meditation. And it kind of clicked for me. And I downloaded the Headspace app. I got through maybe 6 days over the course of a couple weeks. And I just haven't quite implemented it into my life yet. And it's been on my goal list for this year. And hearing this is just kind of reaffirmation that I need to get on the ball.
Well, check it out. It's like somebody that didn't necessarily work out very frequently. It wasn't part of their life, right? And then they start dabbling in it. It takes like, you know, there's a scientific number, but it takes like a few months of something doing something till it becomes a behavior modification.
Right.
So six times, it's like, you know, super good start, but like, let's talk about 6 months here.
Yeah.
And so you have to make it something that's normal.
Yep.
Not something that's a chore.
Yep.
It's not something you mark on your calendar or have to set an alarm for.
Right.
So it's also hard. It's a really hard thing to do.
Yeah.
Like sitting still. First of all, sitting still and relaxing and letting your mind takes a lot of practice. Mm-hmm. People practice for years and years and years.
Yeah.
And they still like here's a thing that even the box breathing. So you choose like how many seconds you want to do your box, like, you know, exhale for a certain amount of time and hold it and then inhale for a certain amount of time. So I'm not going to explain box breathing because it's out there.
And I'll just for the listeners, I'll link to the TED talk about Headspace and to Mark Divine's box breathing in the show notes. So you guys can check that out at theexpansionprojectpodcast.com.
Awesome. So even getting through 10 revolutions of box breathing is difficult.
Yeah.
Because you end up getting like, okay, I'm not, okay, that was two, three. Okay, what about am I doing tomorrow at lunch? Like, and then you forget what you're doing.
Right.
So just being able to do box breathing 10 times is a challenge.
Yeah.
And so it takes practice. You realize how cluttered and stressed out you are.
Yeah.
And if you have time to like watch Friends, if you have time to watch, you know, True Detective and all this stuff, you have time. I mean, this.
I know. I'm bad about making excuses. One of my excuses that I've made to myself was that I got a dog earlier this year, and in the mornings I would try to do the meditation. And I was like, oh, well, I got to take the dog out and this, that. Obviously, it's just excuses, which is terrible. And I don't feel like I make a lot of excuses for other parts of my life. But for some reason, the meditation has been kind of haunting me for the last, 9 months or so. Anyways, on to the next question here in the quick hit section. If there was a movie made about your life, what would be the hardship or obstacle that you had to overcome in order to achieve your success or be the person you are today?
Ooh, wowee. So if, is it like a certain moment in my life that like...
Yeah, and it doesn't have to be a moment, but, you know, maybe an event or, you know, some kind of pinnacle. And maybe there is none. Maybe no, you know, okay.
I mean, I'm not going to sit here and pick because it's not actually, a movie's not going to happen. So the first thought I had was the severe injury to my leg, the hamstring tear that I had that happened because of something that I was lazy with my training and my nutrition. And then learning, actually, at the time, I read a book by Pat Croce. And Pat Croce, it's C-R-O-C-E. Mm-hmm. He's like a rags to riches guy. He ended up starting an athletic training business. He owned the 76ers for a while. Super positive speaker. Mm-hmm. So I read some of his books, and he went through a severe traffic collision and built himself up. Mm-hmm. And so it kind of dawned on me that I didn't accept personal responsibility. Mm-hmm. And I was going through life being good at stuff, but I wasn't really asserting myself. I wasn't really trying. And so that made a switch for me. At the time, I was getting really good at drinking beer. I was depressed. All my buddies were traveling around playing football. And I was not being helpful to them. And I was like, who am I if I'm not an athlete? Mm-hmm. You know, this whole thing. And I actually ended up going to, like, I say they're AA meetings for injured athletes, which that's a thing.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. College athletes are defined, a lot of them define themselves by their sport. And right. They're like, I'm a football player. That's what I do. I mm-hmm. get hurt. Okay, now I'm not a football player. Well, then who am I?
Right.
And so they go, these support groups are out there. And I went to there and it was very helpful. And I totally, totally started changing everything. I was like, I'm going to come back fitter and faster and stronger than I ever have been in my life. Mm-hmm. It's up to me. And if it's up to me, then I can do it. I don't have to blame anybody else. I don't have to point my finger to anyone else. It's all me. And so that changed everything for me moving forward with my life. Mm-hmm. Cool. Accepting personal responsibility and asserting yourself. And I always say, I bring that up a lot. You know how people try really hard in CrossFit? You ever watch a CrossFit workout? Just watch, pick somebody in that class. Mm-hmm. They're really trying hard. There's a lot of beautiful stuff in the triumph of the human spirit. You can see it in any CrossFit class. They're facing a little battle of fitness and mm-hmm. battling the bar, and they're driving on. But I also wonder, are they taking that same energy and that same drive and the same passion to attack the adversity to the other parts of their life? Mm-hmm. When they're at work, are they trying that hard mm-hmm. as they do in that CrossFit workout?
Interesting.
Are they trying really hard to be the best sister they can be or the best father they can be?
Right.
Just something to think about.
Yeah. Yeah, I love it. You've given me a lot to think about during this episode. I appreciate it. A couple more questions we're going to power through here. Have you had any mentors throughout your life?
Yes. So, okay, Pat Croce.
Mm-hmm. Do you remember any of the book titles that you read of his?
Ooh, I wish I did because I went through a bunch of his. He's written like a handful of stuff. He travels around doing talks as well. It's almost like an autobiography. I'd have to look because this is 15 years ago now.
Yeah, no worries.
So I drew inspiration from him. A lot of reading stuff, like Martin Luther King, I've drew inspiration from. A lot of my coaches, certain athletes. And now at work, I have my professional like mentors that I look up to. Now I have my kids. This might be weird. This might sound weird, but even before them, it was always like past family members to me that like my grandparents that were supportive of me that passed. Mm-hmm. Like I don't say they're mentors, but they drive me. Mm-hmm. So like if I'm in here working out by myself and I'm doing burpees and I lay on the ground, I can't lay on the ground and be too long and be lazy because I feel like I'm being watched. And now if I'm laying there, they see that I'm being lazy. Mm-hmm. It's a weird thing I got going on. Like I will go in here and drive myself into the ground. Mm-hmm. Same thing with running. I mean,
yeah, I think that's real interesting to see where people draw that grit from when you're tired on the burpees and you just want to fucking lay down and not get up anymore and stuff. So that's really interesting to hear that.
Yeah. There's that. One of my favorite words of all time is sisu.
Sisu?
Sisu is a Finnish word.
Okay.
If you guys are into resilience and adversity and courage and honor and grit and drive, look up the word sisu.
How do you spell that?
S-I-S-U.
Do you have Finnish in your background?
Nope. Nope. But see, I have it right here. Look, there it is.
Oh, yeah.
It's written up here on my board. So it's When I've studied up on resilience, on grit, on facing adversity, on triumph of the human spirit, there's not that many descriptive words other than those. Hmm. But sisu means all those things.
Right.
It's like a long, you can have a conversation on what sisu means. Mm-hmm. But it's part of the Finnish culture. Mm-hmm. It's what makes them a tough culture. Hmm. It's a mentality. It's how they are.
Yeah.
So
that's interesting. One of the only Finnish people I know is a flatland BMX rider who is one of the most dedicated riders you will ever meet in your life, and just ridiculous tricks that he's just put so many years into, and it, you know, obviously very different from other kind of stuff we're talking about, but similar, you know what I mean? Yep. And he would fit that, I think, just through the amount of work and effort that he put into learning his tricks and perfecting his craft and yep. coming up with his creativity and stuff. So shout out to Marty Quilpa if any BMX riders are listening to this. Final question, but certainly not least, you've actually already are given a handful of these quotes, but do you have a favorite quote or maybe a favorite piece of advice that someone's ever given you?
Ooh, man. See, if you
and it doesn't
around.
Have to be a top one, but, you know, anything that comes to your mind off the top of your head.
The first one is, and it's kind of, it came up again from the Manning family, the Peyton Manning, Eli mm-hmm. Manning, and Archie, is to, what they have going on in common is they want to be a good person.
Mm-hmm.
And do right, do well, do yep. good. That's something that has stuck with me since I was a kid. And sometimes it gets annoying because it makes me feel guilty when I want to do other things.
Mm-hmm.
That guilty conscience is a curse, I tell you. you get to choose how you respond to things.
Mm-hmm.
And resilience. All that stuff has grinded me and has made me kind of how I am. And cool. then having a sense of humor about things.
Yeah.
You know, you look, I have a poster here, you know, weakness is a choice, you know, it says strength and honor on it. Over here is about, down there over here is about resilience. Up there I have a Spartan shield, mm-hmm. right? It's about, that's like the ultimate resilience and toughness in the face of adversity, mm-hmm. right? And their shield is important to me because it protected not only them, but more importantly, it protected their partners.
Mm-hmm.
And so all that stuff and all that drive and to be good for yourself, but also to be better for your team and your family. All this stuff, man, fires me up.
Nice. So we've mentioned a few things in the garage here. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to take a picture of my iPhone. I don't have my real camera with me, but I'll take a picture of the garage if you'll let me and
of course.
Post it on the show notes on theexpansionprojectpodcast.com so you guys can see what we're talking about. So that's going to wrap it up, man. Thank you so much. This has been amazing. I knew that I liked you for a reason, and now I like you even more. So I'm really happy that we got to connect like this, and I appreciate you inviting me into your home. So before we close off, please tell people where they can go to find out more about you. Obviously, Wodcast Podcast on iTunes and Stitcher, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So tell us where else they can go to find out about you, your work, anything else you want to plug.
Well, before I get into that, sure. I want to congratulate you on doing this, starting this whole project that you're doing, man. Follow your passion, chase it down, attack it.
Thank you.
And it's really cool that you get to do stuff like this. I definitely admire it.
I appreciate that.
If you want to listen to the Wodcast Podcast, if you don't, it's you can find it. It is on iTunes. It's on a bunch of apps as well.
Mm-hmm.
The one I use the most is called Podcast app. Mm-hmm. I don't know why. It's just the one I've used to. But it's on iTunes. We're on Facebook. Also Instagram at Wodcast Podcast on Instagram and Twitter. And then I am on Instagram mostly at One Scott Mcgee. And that's the number one, not O-N-E, One Scott Mcgee. And same thing as Twitter, but I use Instagram more than Twitter.
Yep.
And on Facebook as well. And hopefully you guys like some of the stuff I put out there, and full of support and love and sense of humor.
Yeah. So you guys can follow me on all my social networks. They're all just at FatTonyBMX. You can also go check out the show's website. Again, we'll have some cool show notes from this episode as well as the picture from the garage. And that is at TheExpansionProjectPodcast.com. Also, while you're there, they've got the affiliate links on the right side of the page. Remember, if you go to Nutrasuma.com, you can use the promo code FatTony1 to get 20% off of all your supplements and protein. I use their vegan-friendly pea protein, and it's super good. Also, very, very excited. As I mentioned in the beginning of the show, I have just launched my newest company with a partner and friend of mine, and it's called BreakParallel.com. So Scott actually mentioned a TMZ version for yep. CrossFit. We're trying to throw a little bit of that in there. We're trying to throw in some humor. We're going to be posting the best CrossFit and functional fitness content out there, whether that be just, you know, the hottest chicks from Instagram that do CrossFit, or, you know, Killcliff's latest video or whatever it is. It's all going to be in one place. So check out breakparallel.com. Bookmark that and go to it every day, please. And until next time, thank you guys for listening. And thank you again, Scott, for this opportunity.
Hey, thank you, buddy.